Hello and welcome to 007 December. Last Friday, Come Play With Me released Not From Where I'm Standing, an incredible looking and sounding album. It has 20 covers of classic Bond themes performed by The Wedding Present and friends. And what's more, every penny of the album goes to Calm, the campaign against living miserably, a charity that supports people in times of difficulty, preventing suicide by championing life. Tonight is the official launch party for the album, and what better day to do that than December 7th. I'm joined tonight by some very special guests, all of whom have worked incredibly hard to make this album come to life over the past 7 years. We'll be here for the next 45 minutes or so, joined live tonight by some of the artists featured on the compilation, including Terry DeCastro, the legendary Len Liggins, and David Gedge himself. And we'll be showing his brand new video for We Have All the Time in the World, the beautiful song that closes this album. Now, because we're live, you can even send in your own questions. You can do that by using the hashtag 007December or by adding a comment to the Facebook or YouTube streams. And at the end of the show, we'll be revealing the final results of our Bond-themed poll. You can take part in our poll via Twitter. So let's start things off by introducing to you the man behind this project, the one and only David Gedge. Hello, David.
Hello.
How are you? I can.
We're all locked in. Thank you. Oh, excellent. Great.
It's a fantastic looking and sounding record. How did you manage to pull it all together?
Well, it took a long time. It took about 7 years, actually, to finally bring it all together. It all started. We just used to play the one that The Wedding Present did, You Only Live Twice. We played it in a soundcheck in New Zealand, funnily enough, on tour. And at the time, I remember thinking, oh, we should cover this because it's such a great track. You know, a lot of those John Barry ones are brilliant anyway. But and then we kind of buried it for a while, and then we decided to cover it, and then Charlie, actually a drummer at the time, said, why don't we do a whole album of Bond themes? And I thought, well, it might be quite difficult for The Wedding Present to do it, just time-wise, really, you know. But then I kind of threw it open to basically ex-members, current members, like solo projects, like, you know, bands that old members now have, kind of thing. And the response was great, actually. You know, people straight away said, yeah, I'd love to do a Bond thing for you and stuff. And so I got all these kind of tracks sent to me, and nobody wanted any money, really, which is nice. But so I thought, well, if the artist's not actually being paid, we should do something with it, you know, rather than me making like loads of money from it. So we did it as a benefit album, as you know, for Calm. It grew. It's one of those things where we had this idea, and then it just grew and grew, and then, you know, more people got involved, and then the sleeve was designed by some artists called the Connor Brothers, who actually worked with Calm quite a bit, so they got on board, and it's a brilliant sleeve, I think. It evolved and gathered momentum, really.
Well, it's turned out fantastically, and I think you briefly touched on this there. Is everyone else on this album then as big of a fan as the Bond themes as you are?
I don't know, to be honest with you. I didn't ask them, really. I mean, a few people said no, so I presume they were the people who weren't particularly interested in doing it, or that didn't have time, I guess. But I mean, how can you not like Bond themes anyway? They're all brilliant, really. Yeah, even the ones that are a bit rubbish are still good, I think. So yeah, hopefully they're fans.
Because we'd heard that Graham Ramsey appreciates the music, but not so much the films, I think.
Yeah, that's true. That could be said of quite a few people, I think. You know, that, you know, some of the films haven't kind of stood the test of time as well as others, shall we say, especially the kind of dodgy ones of the 1970s and 80s. But the music has always been great. I mean, especially the John Barry era at the very beginning, and then into the 70s, and I think nowadays it's almost people, even with the kind of new Bond themes, a lot of them kind of, you know, kind of reference John Barry. Like, you know, we're going to hear the one by Melanie, Such Small Hands, in a minute, I think. And that was the Adele one from a couple of years ago. And that's like a classic Bond theme, even though it was, you know, nothing to do with John Barry. So it's, yeah, I think there's kind of a culture now of these great dark pop songs with big strings and bombastic brass, etc. So, yeah.
Definitely. So you're also on the album here, A Cinerama, The Wedding Present, and then as yourself as well. Which of those did you find maybe the most challenging?
I'm actually on four times because I'm in Sleeper as well for this. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, gosh.
You treated a Sleeper the track, and I taught myself into doing that as well. I kind of, you know, sneaks in there. To be honest, they're all quite difficult. I think, you know, as a singer, a lot of the chords that are used, especially by John Barry, are very odd, and it's sometimes very hard to pitch, which is fine if there's a lot of instrumentation going on. But I suppose the hardest one was the solo one, which was just me and a piano. And it took me ages, even though, I was very, I knew the song, back to front, and I could sing along with the record. But as soon as you take the guide vocal out, if you like, I'm playing with the piano, I found it quite difficult. And I think it's just there's these weird chords, that I'm not familiar with, really, and then you're often kind of singing notes that are not actually in the chords as well. So it can be quite a challenge.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much. Now, you're going to be joining us a little bit later. Can you tell us what we've got coming up?
Can I? I don't know. No, I can't really. Can you?
Well, I can, and that's just about what I'm going to do. Well, I'll answer it for you. Okay. Now, before we hear from our next guest, I want to have a little look at this video for Skyfall that we've just spoken about. So previously sung by Adele for the 2012 film, this version is by Such Small Hands, featuring current Wedding Present bassist Melanie Howard. This is the end. I've drowned and dreamt this moment. So overdue, I owe them. Swept away, I'm stolen. Let the sky fall. Such a gorgeous video there as well. Now remember, you can hear the full version of Skyfall on Not From Where I'm Standing, the charity compilation album by The Wedding Present and Friends, out now on Come Play With Me. So a couple of days ago, I caught up with Simon Gunning, the CEO of Calm. He's been a Wedding Present fan for a long time, as have I, and we got together to chat about his fandom and his work with Calm. So I'm now joined by Simon Gunning, the CEO of Calm. When you first were approached about this record, what was your initial reaction?
I was really excited. I was very flattered to be asked to write some notes for the sleeve. It's absolutely true. I've been a Wedding Present fan for I think since the moment I first heard them. And it's absolutely true. I've been to fields all around the UK and other countries too, and jumped up and down to Kennedy, countless gigs, countless records, thousands of listens. So it was just such a lovely thing, that something that was a big part of my sort of growing up, and I'm a music obsessive, and I spent many years working in the record business, and to have The Wedding Present and David Gedge come to do something for us now was just such a lovely kind of symmetry. So I was really, really pleased. And it's absolutely true, by the way. I had a band signed to Discordant, the record label, and I was in a band meeting, a label meeting rather, and I saw David Gedge doing some photocopying, and I couldn't go up and say hello because I was just overwhelmed. And I think maybe that's the right thing to do. I think maybe you should just leave that well alone, and I'll just listen to the records.
So tell us a little bit about what you do with Calm then.
Yeah, well, CALM is a suicide prevention organisation, and that is our particular lens on how we feel society is doing. Suicide rose by 11% in the last published numbers, which is in 2019. Very important to stress that there is no evidence that suicide has risen during lockdown. And we focus on how we can prevent that number from certainly rising anymore, but how we can drive it down. And we do that through the opposite of suicide, which is life. And fun and enjoyment and excitement and music and sports and comedy and culture. And we campaign especially towards people who are at high risk. And we just try to get it so that they never get to that place. They never get to such a dark place because CALM's there on their side. And we also encourage different sorts of behaviors, like talking to people around you. It just does you a whole load of good just to unburden yourself and look after what's in between your ears. So one of the things that we do, as well as our campaigning, for example, is we run a helpline from 5 till midnight, 7 days a week, which is free, utterly non-judgmental and totally confidential. Uniquely, it's run by paid, trained people who are there to help. So it's not a volunteer service, which for some people is perfect, but for other people isn't right. So we are leading, as we say, a movement against suicide, but we do it through life. We don't do it through sadness and hand-wringing. We do it through things like collaborations with The Wedding Present, which is just as good as you can get.
So you mentioned the helpline. Is that the best way that people can get in contact with you then?
It's one of the ways. All the detail that you need is at our website, thecalmzone.net. There's loads and loads of stuff on there to help you as an individual, help the people around you. Loads of ways to get involved with CALM and to wear that badge if that makes you feel good. Certainly makes me feel good. And then definitely loads and loads of content on issues that people are facing, especially with coronavirus. And then, yes, you're absolutely right, from 5 till midnight, 7 days a week, if you'd like to talk to somebody and you feel that you haven't got that person close to you, then our helpline is there to help anybody and everybody that needs it.
Thank you so much for chatting with me.
Not at all. Thank you very much. And thank you very much to The Wedding Present.
Now, what we didn't get to see in that interview clip was Simon's new dog, who actually did manage to come into the interview at one point, which is quite funny. Now, up next, we have the incredible Simone White, who will actually be joining us live from New York. Now, her contribution to the album is this luscious sounding interpretation of Goldfinger, originally sung by Shirley Bassey.
Goldfinger. He's the man with the mightiest touch, a spider's touch, such a cold finger beckons you to enter his web of sin, but don't go in. Lies can't disguise what you feel for a golden girl. Knows when he's kissed her, it's the kiss of death.
Now, hello, Simone. So glad you could join us.
Hi.
So, why? I know, it's so weird that you're so far away. So, why did you choose Goldfinger then for this track on the album?
So David sent me a list. I'm not sure how many people saw the list before I saw it, but I was just so excited that Goldfinger hadn't been taken. It was still on the list of available songs to do, and it's just such a classic. Shirley Bassey is amazing, and I just thought it'd be fun to try to interpret it.
And did you find it fun in the process?
Yes, absolutely. And Terry DeCastro was a big help. She came over and we recorded in my bedroom, and she played electric guitar and I was singing. And with regards to what David was saying earlier about the notes, there were some odd notes in there. And Terry really helped me with just getting them right, because she's very good at that. And then we sent it to our friend Paul Haraga, who's also on the album in another way, and he added more instruments as well. And then there it was.
And then there it was. I also wanted to talk to you a little bit about this. Now, seeing as though we're getting quite close to Christmas now, I know you share lead vocals with David on Holly Jolly Hollywood. And the video for that looked like a lot of fun to kind of put together. What memories do you have of that video and that day?
That was really fun, silly day, just driving around Hollywood, just as you see it. There was some reason we weren't actually in the front seat when they were being filmed, I think because we didn't have a car rig. And, you know, it was very low budget, just one guy with a camera, a little video camera. So we were in the back, kind of pretending to, I don't know, it was fun. And one memory I have is there was like a big bus of stargazers that go around for the, you know, to see the stars' homes.
Yeah.
And they saw us and they were all like, oh, and taking photos, like, like they're making something. It's just fun. There was nothing for Christmas. I think we shot it in summer.
Oh, you shot it in summer?
Yeah, there are no Christmas lights or tree. Yeah, you know, there's nothing Christmassy. I think I saw a fan once comment, like, why did you even get some cheesy fairy lights or something just to make it a little more Christmassy? But it's very LA anyway, it's fun.
Well, it looks fantastic. I also wanted to ask you while you're here, how do you see music contributing to well-being and mental health?
As a teenager, it just like saved my life listening to music. And I think that's true for a lot of people in that time in their lives. And then, I mean, I think making music is very healing, just singing, and it's like such a therapeutic thing to sing, and I feel like it's our kind of our birthright as humans to sing, and I feel like just that resonance and vibration that happens in your body is a very healing thing. So even if, you know, alone, wherever, just like toning, making sound if you're feeling unwell, and it's like, because also you're breathing, you're doing the deep breathing, is super healing. And then as a songwriter, I've had many times where I've taken a very dark period of my life that I'm maybe just coming out of, or even maybe still in, and turned it into something in a song, and it's like turning lead into gold. Like the process of it is very healing in itself.
Well, thank you so much for taking the time to talk with us today.
Oh, of course. Thank you, Abi.
No worries. Have a lovely evening. So please remember as well that we are doing all of this for Calm. You can find out a little bit more about them by visiting the website, thecalmzone.net, and by reading through the notes on the inner sleeve of Not From Where I'm Standing. And if you haven't bought the album yet, what are you waiting for? You must buy it before the end of this live stream. Now, this weekend, I also had a chat with John Stewart, guitarist for both The Wedding Present and Sleeper. We talked about the work he's done to help young people and the work he's done over the years with Calm. So, as well as being in both of these incredible bands, you're also the course leader for a Master of Music. How would you kind of define some of the challenges that young musicians now face within the industry?
Well, in lots of ways, there's new opportunities. There's lots of support. There's loads more advice than there was when I was starting out. But there are also some challenges. So I think probably the biggest growth area in music at the moment amongst the youth is production. It's not bands. So that's kind of an issue if you're a guitarist, because that's where a lot of the listenership's going on things like Spotify for younger people. But it also means you have to be a programmer as well. Just being a guitarist is not enough nowadays. But then again, there's lots of opportunities in that too. You can cross genres. You can do great mixes of produced electronic music with guitars on, or live kit. So there's a lot of opportunities in there too. And there's also, you know, someone who teaches on a master's degree, there's great opportunities for studying and researching, looking at things from other perspectives. And there's fantastic scholarship in writing on popular music today, more so than there's been ever, really, I think. And I will plug my book, Dylan, Lennon, Marx and God, which is out next year on Cambridge University Press. If it survives the final peer review read through. So that's all fingers crossed. But there's some great writing on music. So if you like to explore that type and research, there's some great psychological research and scientific research into how instruments work and things like that, and how sound works and the psychology of the whole thing. So there's loads to look at and explore.
I'm really looking forward to reading that. So as well then, you've also supported Calm previously. What other kind of issues did you think, like a lot of musicians, maybe younger musicians, but also as you kind of progress throughout the field, what are the maybe mental health issues that are really prevalent?
Yeah, it's an interesting one, music, because there's a lot of pressure for success. It's super competitive. How you look's really important, which has never been one of my skills. And then you can come in for public criticism, even if it's not in the press, on a Facebook page. And it's this weird mixture of attention, craving for attention, and massive insecurity with your job. So it's a bizarre mixture of kind of ego and fear, which does lead people naturally into a lot of mental health issues, whether it's addiction or alcohol abuse. And if you think about the circumstances of what the job involves as well, night work and things. But then again, you know, I stopped drinking 20 years ago, and I was once in a 12-step meeting, and someone was saying my industry was rife with drinking, and I'm thinking there must be a musician or a journalist, and he goes, I was a furniture restorer. So there's really no those kind of mental health issues can be in any industry. In many ways, music's not special. But I think it's important to understand the psychology behind it. And I think we're just beginning to get a grip on that. And there's lots of good organizations to help people. And I'd encourage anybody to reach out. We were very happy to support Calm on a previous event when very sadly we lost our agent, Chris. So, you know, it's in terms of suicide prevention, the best advice that I ever heard was suicide is a permanent solution to a temporary problem. So I would pass that on. And I think it's important that we continue to support people and also research causes of it and potential solutions and things like that.
Brilliant. Thank you so much for taking the time to talk with us.
Thanks very much for having me on. And thank you very much to everybody who supported this project as well. It's been really cool. So it's been an honor to be involved with it.
Wow, some really, really powerful stuff there. I did also ask John about the differences between working with the wedding present and sleeper. His answer was beyond brilliant, but we just didn't have time to include it in tonight's stream. So make sure you're following Come Play With Me on Twitter and Facebook, and we'll actually be unveiling his answer later this week. Now, also, don't forget to send us in any questions you might have for our guests, either in the stream comments or using the hashtag on Twitter, 007December. Our next guest was part of Cinerama from 1998 to 2018 and The Wedding Present from 2005 to 2010. For this album, she chose to cover a pop classic from 1985, Duran Duran's A View to a Kill. This video... Now we're joined by Terry. Hello, Terry.
Hello. Greetings from Los Angeles.
I know, it's so exotic. It's freezing here.
It's chilly in my office, actually. It's been really hot, but today it's a little tiny bit chilly, but it's all relative, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. It's very, very cold here, unfortunately. So the earliest recorded song on this album is Diamonds Are Forever, which Cinerama recorded in the early 2000s. Can you remember how it all came together in the studio?
Oh my gosh, can I ever remember how it came together? We were at Electrical Audio in Chicago recording with Steve Albini, And I didn't even know we were going to be recording Diamonds Are Forever because David kind of sprung it on us toward the end of the recording session. And I just was thinking, oh no, we've hardly rehearsed this. And that was very unlike David because we usually are very, very well prepared. Well, I was not well prepared for Diamonds Are Forever. And I kind of played it the best I could and tried to remember it. And then I just forgot about it. And months later, when the song was being mixed in the studio with Dare Mason, who did a lot of Cinerama recording and mixes, I walked in and they were mixing Diamonds Are Forever. Unbeknownst to me, they really had to doctor it up quite a bit. So when I was listening, I said, I can't remember playing this well. And David and Dare both went, you didn't love. So, because they had to fix the bass line. So yes, I remember that very well.
So as well then as appearing on several of the songs, you recorded A View to a Kill. Now, why in particular did that one resonate with you?
Well, it wasn't really a song I was a huge fan of, but I thought it would be fun to reinterpret it. Well, I have to say it was my husband's idea. He said that I should do a song that was sung by a man just to kind of turn it around. And I thought that was a good idea. So, and I'm a kid of the 80s. So it was really fun, and it was just so fun learning. I became a much bigger fan of this song after learning it because it's so complicated. Everybody's been talking about the chords, and very true with this one as well, just really different chords that I would never use, and so much fun to reinterpret it. And it was all the instruments in the production are by Paul Haraga, who also of the band Down Pilot, who also produced Simone's Goldfinger and played on it.
It's a very collaborative project.
Yeah, that's so much fun. It's so much fun. I like that about The Wedding Present. There's a lot of cross collaboration.
It's like a family, all like loads of little tentacles going out everywhere and then bringing something together. It's incredible to see happen.
It really is. It's so great. It's so much fun.
So you've spoken as well before about the impact that music has on mental health. Can you tell us a little bit about your kind of feelings towards that and what music means to you?
Well, I just think it's such an amazing collaboration between this project and Calm. And it really didn't occur to me till I was asked this question. And really, mental health and music, just there's a huge symbiotic relationship there, I think. And just like Simone said, music saved my life when I was a teenager. And I think that when you're young and you're discovering music, it's a really great way to find out who you are. And it's a real identity. And it's just something that you can really anchor yourself with. And it's just, I could go on about it forever and ever, but when I was a teenager, I was, you know, morose and depressed, and I was sitting by myself at a party, and I heard the opening riff to Whole Lotta Love by Led Zeppelin. And right then and there is when I decided to become a musician. And then decades later, I met Robert Plant at a festival, and I couldn't speak to him because I was too overwhelmed by how much, just what it meant. Like this, your music in general is the reason I'm here today. And making music is just the most joyful thing that I can think of.
Well, thank you very much for joining us all the way from LA. Incredible.
Thank you so much. Evening. You too. Many thanks.
So our next guest is the legendary Len Liggins. Now, he first joined The Wedding Present for their Ukrainian John Peel sessions in 1989, and then went on to form the Ukrainians with Peter Soloka soon after. Len features on three songs on the album, one with the Ukrainians, one as a solo artist, and one with Follow the Moths, a band that also features former Wedding Present drummer Simon Smith and backline technician and session guitarist John Parks.
You'll never know how I watched you from the shadows as a child. You'll never know how it feels to be the one who's left behind. You'll never know the days, the nights, the tears I've cried. But now my time.
Len.
Hi, Abby. How are you doing?
I'm good, thanks. How are you?
Yeah, fantastic.
Good. Glad you're here. So you're usually referred to as the legendary Len Higgins. How did that nickname come about?
Well, I'm not 100% sure. For years, I thought it was when we did the second Ukrainian wedding present session, which would have been, I think, 1988. And when it went on air, I was, when they do the personnel, you know, read out the personnel for the session, and it was legendary Len Higgins, and I kind of thought, so I thought Peel had done that. But recently, David burst the bubble and told me that when the personnel was being written down on the tape box in the studio, he'd written legendary in with Len Higgins, and it's stuck ever since. So thanks, David.
You can give up a virtual thanks to David. He'll be back with us shortly. You're also on three songs on this album, all very, very different from one another. Do you have a favourite?
I don't have a favourite. They're all very different, I think. The Follow the Moss one that we've just seen, it's all about drums and bass. It's got Simon on that was with the wedding present, I think, from 1988 to 97, whatever, about 10 years. The Ukrainians one was a strange one because we tend to just drink and record or play or whatever. And so we just ended up, we met up in a rehearsal studio and we spent, I think, about 2 hours just working out what key we were going to do it in. And just doing our thing, and we went and recorded it. It's rough, but I like that. And then the my track, the Thunderball. I wanted to address the thing about sexism. I think that's rife in. I know it's a fun album and so on, but I don't know. I thought it just needed to be said. But I wanted to do it in a kind of in a light way, not in a kind of po-faced or kind of way. So I decided to do something kind of a bit comic, or at least I think it hopefully might come across as being a bit comic. But they're all three different songs, three different lots of people, three different approaches. I couldn't possibly have a favourite, no.
Well, you've just touched on something there that I want to bring back up. Your shows with the Ukrainians are known for being insanely great parties. How have you coped with that this year?
Well, we do actually occasionally have a band Zoom party, and we it's a bit like hotel rooms after gigs where you know the vodka breaks out and so on. It's actually much more healthy because we're not sharing each other's vodka bottles and stuff. It's a bit strange not playing live for so long, but the good thing is it has allowed a bit of time for doing other things. So for instance, you know, we talk about the Follow the Moss, but Follow the Moss has we've recorded an album. It's not mixed or anything yet, but it's recorded and that's going to come out next year, and we would not have had time to do that had I been doing stuff with the wedding present. And I've also had a chance to do a solo EP.
A nice bit of casual branding there.
Not that I want to plug it or anything, you know, but it's been nice to do different things, you know, and nice to do things that aren't musical as well, and just, you know, chill and enjoy being alive.
Definitely. Well, I also want to bring up, while we're on the subject of partying, if people in the audience, you've got to give this disclaimer, if they are over 18, you absolutely must check out Len's video for Thunderball. You can find it over on Come Play With Me's YouTube channel. It really is something. It's incredible.
I'm only wearing a hat.
And that's all context we need to give. Bathtub, hat, that's all we need.
If people to want to see it, then I don't know what will.
Well, thank you very much for sitting down and having a chat with me. It's been a pleasure.
Cheers, Abby.
I'll see you soon. So we're now getting close to the end of our broadcast, unfortunately. However, that does mean we're getting even closer to our play of We Have All the Time in the World. But first, let's welcome back David Gedge.
Hello.
Hello, David. How have you found it so far?
It's been great, actually, hasn't it? Yeah, it's been nice to see some old friends on there and international conversations going all over the place. That's brilliant, yeah. I'm just looking forward to seeing the video again now. Yes.
Oh, God, me too. Me too. So I want to bring this up as well. Over the past week, we've been asking everyone at home what their favourite Bond theme is. We've had four separate polls running all week, one for each side of the album, to find out what theme everyone at home loved most. We've had a lot of votes come in, and for some of the polls, it's been a really, really close call. But we've broken them down into the four top tracks. So for side A, our champion was Goldfinger. For sides B and C, we had Live and Let Die and Nobody Does It Better. And then finally, for side D, we had A View to a Kill. So with those in mind, our four finalists, which one do you think is going to be the winner tonight?
I'd say they're all good, but I don't like the fourth one, A View to the Kill. That's a Duran Duran one, isn't it? A View to a Kill. That's the one Terry did. Terry's version is so much better than the original. I don't know, Live and Let Die is probably, maybe, I don't know. They're all good. Goldfinger will be my personal favourite out of those, I think. But I suspect it might be Live and Let Die because it's a bit of a rocker.
I think we'll see. I think Goldfinger might be my choice of the night anyway. Well, should we have a look? Should we reveal the poll results?
Let's do it. Bated breath. Ooh, it's a bit blurry.
Oh, there we go. Look, you were right. You were right.
Oh, Live and Let Die, yeah, I see.
Mm-hmm. You were right. I wonder why that is.
I think it's probably because the people who voted are Wedding Present fans, and they're of that age where... Because I think often, you know, people's favourite Bonds are the ones they saw first or kind of grew up with and stuff. And I think a lot of them will be of that era, the kind of 70s there. And but it's a great tune as well.
It's fantastic. And I think we were very close with Goldfinger, but it was neck on neck for so many of them by the looks of it.
Yeah, well, like I said before, they're all classics, I think, really.
They're all incredible. And don't forget, everybody at home, you can hear the brand new versions of all of those songs on the album, including some brilliant covers by the guests we've had on tonight. Now, before we finish, we have had a few questions in from our audience. So we're going to do a bit of a quick fire with those, I think.
Okay, let's do it.
Let's see. Oh, it's so small. Hi from Leeds. this is so small.
That it is, I know. I can't even read it.
What look? Can you read it?
I think it says what took you away from the city.
The city to Brighton. There we go.
well, actually, because the wedding present started in Leeds, and you know we were based in Leeds for many years. I was born in Leeds actually, but then it came to a point when I was the only one left in Leeds itself. Everybody else was elsewhere, Halifax and Doncaster and all over the place, really. And then I started doing Cinerama, my side project, and I just kind of felt like, well, I could live anywhere in the world, really. And so it's a bit of a long story, this, but I ended up going to Seattle because I always fancied living in America for a while. So I went to Seattle. And then when I came back from there, there was no real kind of reason why I had to go back to Leeds, really. So I just thought, well, maybe I should go and live somewhere else. And Brighton, I've always loved it. I've always loved it down here. I've got quite a few friends down here, and you know, it's nice being on the south coast and stuff. It's the weather's better than Leeds, to tell you that for a start. It felt like a change, and I've kind of been here for 20 years now, so I guess it was. I suppose I must like it.
Do you think you'll ever go back to Leeds?
Oh, my chair went down. I don't know. Sorry about that. You can never say never, can you? I don't know. I've got no plans to. Sorry, just let me just adjust my chair.
Adjusting. This is the thing with being at home doing home broadcasting. It's nice working from home, but the chairs aren't great. I'm sat on the floor at the minute, so
it's very squeaky as well. Oh, you sat on the floor, are you? That's a good idea. Should have done that. I wouldn't have had the chair disaster. It's weird going back to Leeds now because I don't feel like it's my home anymore. It's like, you know, because I go there to play concerts and I stay in a hotel, and even though, you know, I'm very familiar with the city and the way people speak to me, and you know, it's all familiar. It doesn't feel like home. It's kind of a strange feeling, but I wouldn't rule it out. Yeah, why not?
Let's see if we've got another question. Is there one popping up? Oh, that's another.
That's the same one, I think.
Here we go. So, can you rate the bonds in order from more to less than B, please? Go.
So, what does he mean? What did he or she mean by that? Did they mean that more is the, because there's, you know, more wasn't the first one and laser wasn't the last one, so I don't know.
Between that.
Yeah, between that, okay. what would that be? Well, actually, there's only one between laser and being more, and that was Sean Connery from memory. But if they're asking what my favourite Bond is, I would probably say Sean Connery now. I think it used to be Roger Moore, but then when I've actually watched all the films again this year because I got a box set a couple of years ago, and I decided to kind of, I suppose, I think maybe even inspired by this album, I decided to go back and watch all the films. And some of the 70s films are a bit dodgy. I think Len hit the nail on the head before when, you know, there is a lot of sexism in them, and some of the jokes are just not funny. You know, you just think that doesn't work really. So I think I've probably revised my opinion now that I think some of the early ones are good. But then I think that the Daniel Craig ones, the recent ones, are great films. He's actually my least favourite Bond, funnily enough. But I think the films are really good, actually. They're really kind of exciting and a bit more suspenseful, a bit closer to the original films as well, and the original books. So, but they're all different, really, aren't they? You know, I think the Roger Moore ones, as I say, play it for laughs, and then, you know, Pierce Brosnan, I think he was one of my favourite Bonds as well. So,
well, hopefully he's that's answered Bond, the question Abby. Between those. See, I'm actually a big fan of Craig, but that's my era.
Yeah,
so, as I said before. That's my thing. I grew up watching those.
It didn't look like a James Bond to me, though. Because James Bond to me is kind of like dark and slimmer. I don't know, he seems a bit like a muscle-bound kind of thug,
yeah,
really.
I know what you mean. He's a little bit less kind of like panther-esque, I think, kind of sneaking down the back corridors. He's a bit more, like you said, a bit more, I don't know what that would mean, what that would entail. But he's
muscle,
personally my favourite.
Muscle.
Okay. That's the one.
Great film.
Let's see if we've got another question. Ah, this is a good one. So what is your next collaboration project, if you have one lined up?
To be honest, I've not done a lot of collaborating. I suppose the main thing, you know, recently, obviously on this album, I collaborated with Sleeper because we did the Bond song, and then also because John, as we learned before, is actually in Sleeper and The Wedding Present, and we've done an album of kind of lockdown songs, which is going to come out in January, because I have my own festival in Brighton now every year. Obviously, it didn't happen this year, so we decided to do some acoustic versions, films to show instead, for like an online version, and people really liked it, so we thought we'd release it as an album. And so we got Louise Wenner from Sleeper to come and sing on that as well, so I guess that's a collaboration that's in reverse, really. So I was in Sleeper for a song and she's in The Wedding Present for this one. But yeah, so that comes out next year. I suppose my new autobiography has just come out recently. It's called Tales from the Wedding Present. That's a collaboration with Terry. It's all the same people popping up here, isn't it? But yeah, Terry kind of co-writes that with me. And then we've got a good friend of ours, Lee Thacker, who's the artist. So that just came out. It's a comic book form. It's autobiography in comic book form. Yeah, I suppose they're both collaborations.
Fantastic. Well, we did touch on that a little bit earlier, I think, this idea that a lot of what you do and a lot of what The Wedding Present does, and Cinerama as well, kind of revolves around the same people. And there is almost like a kind of family aspect to it. Is that something that you kind of feel as well?
Family is probably a bit of a strong word.
it's
kind of more like, you know, why wouldn't I do that really? Because I've met so many talented people over the years, and if I can draw on them, you know, in order for them to contribute to a project like this one, for instance, I'd be stupid not to really, because as I say, there's a wealth of great people out there who I've worked with, because I've been doing this for so long now, 35 years. I've met a lot of different type of people who've got different types of skills as well. So it's always, you know, I've never been one of those kind of dictatorial kind of band leaders who has got a vision for his group or her group and nothing else can, you know, sort of divert from that. I've always been very open to other people and other people's contributions and ideas, really. So, yeah.
Fantastic. That's all the time we've got for questions at the minute. We have almost reached the end of our live broadcast, unfortunately. But before we say goodbye, we do have an extra special treat for everybody at home. Now, we may not have all the time in the world tonight, but we do have all the time in the world. There we go. So here it is. The very... I didn't. I'm not taking credit for that. Carl can take credit for that. Our producer. So here it is, the very, very special world premiere of the video by David Lewis Gedge. Enjoy.
We have all the time. Precious things love has in store. We have all love in the world. If that's all we have, you will find we need nothing.
Oh, what a gorgeous video.
Thank you. Yeah, it's very nice, isn't it?
That's lovely. I'm very, very envious of that beach that you're strolling along.
It's just, it's near Brighton. It's not actually Brighton. It's just down the road. It's Port Slade, actually, the little town. But we had to go there because it was a bit more deserted. The people walking around the background otherwise. But no, yeah, it's very atmospheric, I think. He did a really good job.
Yeah. Yeah, it's gorgeous.
A friend of ours called, sorry, I was going to say, he's edited by, I should name him really, shouldn't I? Jack, who's in a band called Animal House from Leeds, from Brighton here. So, yeah, you're confusing me now.
Well, I was just about to say, you saying, oh, well, it's down the road from me in Brighton. I'm in Leeds right now. No beaches around here that I can go for a nice walk on. Very, very envious of that. But we are, unfortunately, at the end of the show. So, David, thank you so, so much for joining us. Just as a reminder as well for everybody at home, Not From Where I'm Standing is out now on Come Play With Me on both vinyl and CD. So make sure you grab a copy. Links for all of that are in the comments and have been on screen at various points tonight. Now, I just want to say as well, thank you to everyone involved. It's been incredible. Everybody has this mutual love for such an incredible band. It's really been a pleasure. And I also want to thank Come Play With Me for hosting this event and for another incredible release. Someone that's from Leeds, they're constantly producing some of the most brilliant music from local artists, and their magazine has shown me, and I'm sure so many other people, some incredible local kind of finds as well. And then finally, a big thank you to everyone at home for tuning in. I hope you've had a fantastic evening. I know I have, and I'm sure everyone else on the stream has as well. But it's goodbye from us.
Goodbye.